To my left, you may know Marilyn Patterson Grant, and to my right, you may know Jim Shepherd, former Deputy Chief of Police for the Rochester Police Department. Before we get started, there's one quote, one paragraph I'd like to read to you. It's from one of my favorite books called No Excuses, Closing the Racial Gap in Learning. It says, no excuses, that is the message that superb schools deliver to their students. And that is the message that schools and school board members need to hear. Sure, some kids are easier to teach than others, but dysfunctional families and poverty are no excuses for widespread educational failure. That is the premise in which we've done everything here. In looking at in the past 60-somewhat days at the findings, and what you are receiving is a pared-down version of this 73-slide presentation that we gave to the Board of Education last Monday. In looking at every facet of the district, every slide in here represents a conversation, a finding that we went back and dug for some more information and see how we're doing. In some parts, we're doing phenomenally well, like pre-K, for instance, best pre-K program in the country and most Western European countries. When you look at our elementary schools, while not perfect, some work has been done there in the past 7 years. We've got phenomenal teachers who are working hard. We've got some who are struggling. Same thing goes for principals, and same thing goes for central administrators. The one thing we looked at, of course, was to keep going back to our three core values: equity, achievement, and accountability. We talk about achievement. We don't talk about improving achievement. We talk about accelerating improvement, academic improvement. The equity issues were huge. We've got schools that have 50% special needs kids, while some have 0% special needs kids. If you are an English language learner or a bilingual Hispanic kid, you've got two high schools you can go to. Our Hispanic population, the ones who are bilingual, don't have a choice of schools like many of our students. So those kinds of equity issues, where some schools, for instance, have many, many assistant principals, some have none. So the way we've done business will change in fundamental ways. In the look at the current org chart, the one we'll put in place by July 1st of this school year, we've created two key positions, one deputy superintendent for teaching and learning, and I've named that person, Marilyn Patterson Grant, formerly our chief academic officer. The other position is going to be deputy superintendent for administration, a yet-to-be-named person. We're still in the search process for that. What that does for me as a superintendent, it gives me two key people I can turn to and have a pulse of what's going on in the entire organization. The deputy superintendent for administration is someone who will run the entire back office operation. I tell people that if the back office operation, if it's visible, it's not working. If it is transparent, it is working well. And I can tell you right now, it's too visible. We've got issues with food services. We're finding all kinds of issues with food services. If a principal or teachers have to worry about food services, it is not working. So we need someone who will make that transparent to the lives of teachers and the lives of principals so they can focus on what's important, and that's the teaching of our kids. Of course, all that said, safety is a primary concern for many of us, the safety of our kids as they walk to school and the safety of our kids and our teachers and principals once school is in session. One of the reasons we tapped into Jim rather early to look at what we need to do around, one, reducing the number of suspensions. We're not looking, again, someone asked me recently, are you not going to suspend kids to reduce suspension? That is not the intent. The intent is to be proactive in looking at the behavior of our children, as well as once they misbehave, the right kind of consequence is dished out. Right now, for instance, we do not have a code of discipline for our students. We have a code of conduct, but is not specific enough to give principals the kinds of guidelines that they need to dish out the right kinds of consequence for different kinds of infractions. That will be in place before the school year starts next year. Of course, we'll do this in collaboration with the RTA, with parents, and our principals in developing this code of discipline for students. You've heard about our rolling safety audits. In looking at the practices of schools. What we're finding early, by the way, is that lots of quality of life issues that very often lead to bigger issues. When you have students walk the halls with impunity or cursing at adults left and right, and they're not being challenged, the message that goes back to children is that we can keep doing this at will. That needs to change. And if we don't have an environment that is conducive to learning, our teachers cannot teach and our students cannot learn, and the fear will continue to exist. So Jim, of course, is leading that work and will publish this code of conduct after extensive collaboration before the school year starts next year. One office that we're looking to create as well is an office we're calling the Office of Youth Development and Family Services. This, again, one-stop shopping for our families and for our students, where guidance services, student placement, as well as the Office of Parent Engagement. And notice we're calling it parent engagement. So we're looking to put the onus on us to engage our parents and to empower them. Our goal, as has been done in Miami-Dade in Florida, is to turn our supply parents into demand parents. Right now, too many of our parents are supply parents, where they bring their children to school, and we don't see them again for the rest of the school year or school years. But to turn parents into demand parents, where they are as demanding as the suburban parents, as to work for us, to empower them to understand the kinds of questions to ask of teachers and principals, is the work for us, to even help them around the development of their children. That's the work for us. The last thing last two things we'll talk about. One is that, as you've seen in the DEC this morning, we will so change the structure of our district into three separate clusters. We'll have a chief of school in each separate cluster. Right now, we're looking at possibly doing that along the lines of our placement centers, and each of these individuals will be directly responsible for the principals in the schools, and they'll report directly to me. One thing that I really am worried about is making sure that the number of layers between my office and that of the principal's office is as small as possible, so I have direct contact with our principals. And if you look at the way the police department and other services in the city are clustered, it's going to fall along similar lines. And the goal, of course, for these clusters is to create community, where you have principals, police, fire, healthcare, our principals and our chief meeting on a regular basis, looking at the needs of that particular geographic area. So all of that, and making sure that we have a performance management system for the folks here at Central, that everyone here is held accountable to the success of our children is part of the work. So as you can see, there's a lot that we need to get done in a short amount of time. We will resist the temptation of trying to accomplish all of it at once, but we certainly will put stops in place to look at the best levers to move the organization, the tipping points that we need to create to making sure that we're creating success in a short amount of time. And of course, the accountability starts with me. And the two big goals I've given to the Board of Education is that within 5 years, our graduation rate will be 75% at minimum, and that every elementary school will have met No Child Left Behind accountability status, meaning what they call AYP, adequate yearly progress. Those are not maximum goals, they're minimum goals. And of course, we have benchmarks, and we'll have benchmarks set along the way for everything that we do. And we'll create, in the course of the next few months, growth models for every school. So if a school is at the 92nd percentile, how do we move it to 94, the 95, the 96? Because every organization needs to continue to grow, otherwise they will fail. And the last piece, of course, is the dream schools. And what we'll do is we'll look at the bottom performers of all the schools, and we'll put intense scrutiny on these schools. There's a similar initiative right now in Buffalo. It's been done in New York City. It's been done in other places around the country, including, of course, San Francisco, my friend Ollie Nackerman, who's just about to take over Philadelphia. What you see when you create that kind of intense support structure for a failing school is radical improvement. And of course, if after a year we don't see traction, we need to be brave and begin to shut these places down. 25% graduation rate in any school is unacceptable when you're losing 75% of kids. So if you have an environment that is not moving, we need to be brave and create something that is different and that will meet the needs of our students.